it's great to have you all here. If the board doesn't mind, I'd like to reorder things a little bit so that we can honor the folks.
Oh, we're on.
Oh, good.
Yay.
Hi. Perfect. Oh, great. Thank you. All righty.
Woohoo.
I'm not sure. Okay. All right, thanks. Bye.
We're on.
We're on?
We're on. He's hoping the sound's working as well.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, again, so it's on the tape, I guess. Welcome to this school board meeting of May 20th, 2010. And I guess we'll just continue with, as I was saying, and go straight to the New Hampshire Scholar Awards, if the board is in agreement with that. And we can save them, if they'd like to leave, the joy of watching us approve our minutes and the rest of that. So with that, Dr. Lister.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. This is a presentation to some students here and their families that we thought it was very important to recognize them. There was a letter that I sent to each one of the families. If I could just read that very quickly, that'll give you a gist of where we're headed here. So congratulations for being chosen as a recipient of the Granite State Scholar Awards and the National Merit Program as a recipient. We're very proud of all the students and would like to invite you as a family, if you're able, to the May 20th school board meeting, which begins at 7:16, so we can honor you at this televised meeting. Promoting high standards and recognizing student accomplishments in the three A's, academics, arts, and athletics, is an important part of quality education in the Newmarket schools. We look forward to seeing you again tonight. Congratulations. And we really do appreciate that everyone took the effort to be here this evening, because this is really important. In all seriousness, we recognize students on a regular basis for, you know, excellence in athletic teams and other activities, and certainly every academic accomplishment is just as important, and we want to make sure we recognize students. So what we'd like to do is maybe ask, when I call your name, we have a certificate of excellence that we'd like to provide you with. And this is the season of the year where we start giving lots of awards, because it's the end of the school year, graduation's coming. We want to recognize everyone for being accepted for in colleges and for what they've accomplished here in the Newmarket schools. Whether you're a senior graduating or whether you're an undergraduate, we certainly want to recognize you, and because we think it's really important that you have all these connections to the community. Because I know that we say on a regular basis, this is really all about community. And we want to make sure that you're recognized for your accomplishments. And we're very proud of you. So glad you're here. So maybe what we could do is, when I call your name, if we could ask the student to come up here, we'd like to shake your hand. And then we'll present you with a certificate. And after that, you're okay to go, because I'm sure everyone has homework. Because you don't make these accomplishments without doing some homework. So we want to give you the opportunity to engage in your life and homework and everything else, unless you'd like to stay here and listen to this meeting that's going to be very exciting and share things. So so the first one we'd like to have come up is Sage
Makami.
Makami. Kind of like running the gauntlet.
No, right here. Where am I going? Okay.
There you go.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
And Sage is one of the National Merit Program recipients. The second recipient is Tyle Foster. We have five Granite State Scholars. The first person we'd like to see is Ben Chase.
Congratulations,
Ben. Well done.
Congratulations.
The next person is Rihanna James.
Congratulations.
Next, we have Aaron Levinstein. Next, we have Eric Schmidt. Next, we have Nick Selling. Now, I think there was a request for somebody who wants to take some pictures with someone with the board or...
Can I have the students come up right around, right in front of the table here?
And I'll take a picture. We can kind of stand up in back of them and...
Yep.
Does that work?
Yes.
Perfect. Eric, right in front of me. That's good.
That's good. Here we go. One, two, three. One more. One, two, three. Maybe not. There we go. All right. Thank you.
So once again, we'd like to thank you for being here and families taking the effort. I know you're proud of your sons and daughters, and certainly we are as well. And we look forward to continuing the education here and of excellence and working with the students. So if you'd like to not stay, that's okay with us. But if you'd like to, certainly. Thank you very much.
I'll go home and watch it online.
Yes.
The rest of the.
Yeah, they'll be watching from home, I'm sure.
See that?
Sure.
No.
It's definitely a different energy in the room. We've got a full house.
Yeah.
But, okay. Well, thank you for staying, brave few. So I guess let's continue with our agenda with the minutes, if we could, from the May 6th meeting.
To accept the minutes of May 6, 2010.
Second that.
Okay, are there any discussions? Clarifications or?
Of course. I was just wondering, on the top of page 2, when we talked about the nutrition program, they list all those people, and although I love Nancy, was she really a part of the nutrition program, or was she just really here for our non-public that evening?
Nancy was here, not part of the program. She was here as an observer, and I think I made the comment that she was here as a cheerleader.
Because it just, all right, so it just, I noticed her name. I didn't know if she should be grouped with all those people. And then on page 3, second paragraph up, Superintendent Bob Lister, I think it should say, suggested that the high school graduation be on Friday, June 11th. And the next sentence, the last day of classes for students will be June 24th. And that is it.
It is, the last day for students and staff is Thursday, June 24th. And it'll be a full day for staff and a half day for students.
Okay. Anything else? Okay, I see those as friendly changes.
Yep.
Is there any other comments? Okay. Hearing none, then all those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, and we had non-public that evening as well.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes from the non-public meeting on May 6th.
I'll second.
Any discussion? Okay, hearing none, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
Mr. Chairman, could we just make sure that the item above the approval of minutes is, you mentioned that just in case there are any visitors that want to speak? I don't know if there are, but just in case.
Thank you. I think everyone who's here is a part of the program, but if anyone were to make a comment as a member of the public, this is the time that we have allotted for that. All those seniors weren't that wordy. Okay, thank you for that, highlighting that oversight. So next on the agenda, as this is the first meeting after the election, congratulations to Chet and Linda for the landslide victories on both of your parts. This, though, is the organizational meeting where the board chooses its chair and vice chair for the next 12 months. So at this point in time, I will open the floor for nominations for chairperson.
I nominate Cliff Chase for chairperson.
I'll second.
Thank you. Are there any other nominations? Any other nominations? Okay. Next step is, I guess, a vote regarding that, but I would rather not preside over that. So I will turn to the vice chair for the moment.
So all of those in favor of
electing Cliff as chair, please say aye.
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 We'll assume that you're abstaining.
I'll abstain, yes, thank you.
So the ayes have it.
Well, thank you. I'm honored.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. I appreciate the support. Then moving on to vice chair. Does anyone wish to make a nomination regarding that position?
I would love to nominate Linda to be vice chair in her. You know, why not continue?
Okay. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Thanks, Chad. Any other nominations? Okay. Hearing none, all those in favor of Linda Manigani serving as vice chair for the coming year, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? You can't oppose.
I won't oppose.
Okay. Thank you. You were in the seat together again.
Yeah, thank you very much, folks.
Okay, so now I'm on as chair. Once again, this is the point where we discuss very briefly committee assignments for the coming year. And as we did last time, I'd like folks to have the opportunity to ponder the list and get back to me what your preferences are for what roles you'd like to see yourself in. I'd just like to highlight a couple that and maybe we can add to this because our new superintendent isn't here yet. He's not here to protest. There's a few that have been handled by the superintendent in the past, and I'm not sure we really have need to change that. Those are the Public Safety Committee, the rep to the council has been a shared responsibility of the chair and the superintendent. Although if someone besides the chair would like that role, I think that's good to have two people in that responsibility. And then the last two, the District Safety Committee and the rep to the Cable TV Committee, if that is even in existence at the moment. I'm not sure.
We won't need a negotiation team this year.
Well, I was thinking about that last night and recalling a conversation that with Chet in particular.
We got to do something.
That there's some things we might want to, okay,
yeah,
not necessarily work in earnest, but work towards.
Keep working towards the next
because,
time, mm-hmm, right?
Mm-hmm. As you recall, it's just a two-year,
yeah,
contract.
Mm-hmm.
So if we can,
you want to get started early,
lay the groundwork early, it'll be a less painful process.
It's the wording of the contract,
yeah,
we should go over.
Now, would it seem to be that, like, what is this, the District Facility Study Committee, would that, I mean, where Chet has already been, mm-hmm, deeply embroiled in that, is that something that we would just leave, or, I mean?
If every, you know, if others are interested in that role, then they, and there has been another, whether it's that or a different position, you know, make your thoughts known. It doesn't need to be now. We,
yeah,
can.
Well, I'm just, are there more than one people? I mean, do some of these?
Yes, that's two.
That's a two.
Typically,
that's two.
We've had that as two.
Okay. When I say two board, okay. Okie doke.
So next meeting, you want us to have put some thought into this and re-volunteer for?
I would like to be, to have a good idea coming into next meeting.
Okay.
So if you can email me,
sure,
or give me a buzz,
okay,
what your thoughts are, that would be great.
Okay.
Okay. Excellent. Bob, I've got a couple things written on my agenda for good news, but I'm going to guess you're going to hit them before I do. So what do we have for good news this evening?
Well, Mr. Chair and board members, this is the best part of the agenda, being able to talk about the good things that are happening in the Newmarket schools and community, and I'd just like to mention a couple of things. Certainly recognizing students tonight for excellence in academics and other awards is certainly a highlight of the day and certainly a highlight of the week. We also, in the next few weeks, as I said, we'll be celebrating the accomplishments of staff and students around the graduation time and at different events, banquets and different events through the week, so we're looking forward to that. We have a nutrition task force headed by Lisa Kumpf, as a result of the recommendation that Meg Looney made, and we are have asked Lisa to convene a meeting, which she is going to do, and they would like to come back and make a report back to you after they've had a chance to meet a couple times. But they're very enthusiastic about that, and that will include some of the items that we had at the last board meeting, which include the wellness, the nutrition, the health curriculum, and several other items. So we see that all coming together, which is a great thing. Also, you'll see on your calendar a list of events that are available for different activities for the last month of school. We hope you can participate in some of these events, and maybe we'd like to include the items that you have if I haven't hit them.
It was just a detail, I guess I'd add, it was that I was happy to hear that the nutrition task force included staff, students, and parents were all represented in that group. So it's not just a small group within the school, it's the staff, very broad representation, as well as parents and students. So I think that's an important way to proceed with that. You covered it all?
Yes.
Or yeah, for now.
The highlights.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Then next we have, back into our program, the facilities SFC Engineering Partnership have done a study as based on a board request or a request from folks in our community to study the facilities. When was that? Was that some months ago?
Last year.
11 months ago.
Last summer.
So I look forward to hearing what you folks have to share.
And if I may, while Jeff is coming to Jeff, can I ask you to go to the microphone? Would you mind?
Oh, sure.
So people at home can hear what you have to say. This is Jeff Murphy from SFC Engineering, who we met with, and he's here to talk about the scope of work and some other information. I'd also just like to recognize in the room also Dan Bisson from Harriman Corporation, and I know that everyone knows Dan. And so we'll turn it over to Jeff, if that's okay.
Okay, thank you for having me in tonight. What I'd like to do is kind of give you a synopsis of the last 12 months or so of what we've done for the district and kind of where we stand today, and then I can answer any questions you guys may have. Interrupt me at any time and we can expand. Last summer, at the request of the town fire department, the school retained SFC Engineering to do a review of the junior high school and the elementary school as part of the annual inspection that the town of Newmarket is responsible for, derived from the Department of Ed and reported to the state fire marshal. So they asked for some assistance with that, which we were contracted to do. So we came in last summer and did a site evaluation of both schools for specifically fire and life safety code compliance with the state fire code. We didn't look at Department of Ed requirements or anything like that. It was strictly the safety of the building. We completed that study last summer and issued our reports. I believe it was the end of June when they finally made it from our office to the school district as well as to the town as part of the agreement for our review. Following that, the fire department followed up with various members of the school as they saw fit and needed to understand our report. We had a couple conversations with them. And then they reported those findings to the state as they're required to. I believe it was in December when it all got ironed out and the forms went into the state. So since then, we've been kind of working with various members of the school, including the maintenance department, to kind of go through our report, make sure we were on the ball and had the right information. We've talked to Harriman Associates to make sure that we understood the history as they've been involved in the school district for quite some time now. And started to kind of take our report and formulate it down into some topics so that we could best come back to the board tonight and give you a rundown on what we found. So short answer is both buildings have some deficiencies that need to be addressed in the future. It's the same with every building in the state of New Hampshire. It's just kind of par for the course. What we did is a complete review of the facilities for the state fire code, which includes sprinklers if present, means of egress, emergency lighting, exit signage, fire alarm systems, and the general safety of the school. Some reports were generated, which I believe will be distributed to the board once we've kind of had a time to talk. But in essence, the recommendations that our firm has run the whole gamut of some operational concerns with how the facility is utilized, some housekeeping issues that are always going to come up in reaching as far as in the high school, some facility concerns in the actual structure of the building posing some code issues that need to be addressed in the future. So my intent tonight is not to get into the minutiae of them, but just kind of hit the highlights for each school, if that's the will of the board. Mm-hmm. What I'd like to do is kind of talk about the elementary school first. And that's the easier of the schools, being one story, newer than the high school, and a pretty straightforward layout in terms of corridors, classrooms, and how things are put together. So the report on the elementary school is relatively good. The building itself doesn't have any major problems.
there's some doors that need to be looked at that require ratings, and we need to do a little bit more research into that building on how it was built and where those doors came from. As some of them have labels, some of them don't. They've been kind of altered over the years. So we got to look at some doors. The fire alarm system needs to be upgraded, and just due to the age of it, that's the natural progression of fire alarm systems in terms of notifying people, meeting the accessibility requirements, making sure we have strobes everywhere for anybody who's hearing impaired, those types of issues. And in the bulk of the remainder of the items are just operational issues. Things like corridor doors need to be kept closed for smoke compartmentation and fire protection within the building. And for ventilation purposes, most people want to keep the doors open. So there's some institutional programs that, you know, we can talk about and see what we can do to solve those. But that's the summary of the elementary school. There's nothing that jumps off at the page of major facility concerns. It's more operational, some isolated areas that need some upgrading and so forth. Couple exit signs, and I'll get this list out to anybody who needs it.
So before you go on, regarding the doors,
yes,
it sounds like some of them maybe have been replaced over time, and some of them, and they're not labeled as the whatever their rating is for containment of fire or what have you.
That's correct, and also some of them have been repaired or painted over time. So if there was a marking on them, it may have been covered, and that's why it needs a little bit more investigation. I don't want to come out and tell you that they're all bad, mm-hmm. without having the documentation to back that up. So our initial report looks for those labels that we weren't able to locate. So that leads to the tendency that they may be a problem, but it does not guarantee that they're a problem. Just needs a little bit more research.
With the safety issue, I'm concerned about the heating portion of the building,
the boiler
itself. Yes. Did you look at that at all?
No, we looked at the facility. We're not mechanical engineers that would look at the operations. I know a facility report was done in the past, which I...
What year?
It was done in 2003, I believe, was the last time that the facility was looked at in that much detail.
In the windows themselves through the whole building?
From an energy point of
yes.
view? Again, that's not an issue that the state fire marshal's office or the town fire department looks at as a life safety concern of the building. So that was not within our scope at this time.
Great, thanks.
So that's the elementary school. It's relatively easy. I like to start that way. As people, I'm sure, can imagine, the high school is a different ball of wax altogether. Several additions, several construction types, modified over time to meet the program needs that the school district had in terms of reassigning rooms as classrooms or staff areas and switching back and forth over the years. So the list on the high school is shorter but more significant. It's more global issues at the high school as opposed to the specific issues at the elementary school. The biggest issue is just the generic means of egress within that building. One of the biggest issues of the state fire code is getting people out of the building in a safe manner. What they want in order to do that is any stairwells or components that you need to use to leave the building, they want to make sure you're protected till you get to the outside. And the error of some of those additions and some of the portions in that building, that was not the major concern at the time. So one of the major issues in that building would be the open stairs that are located throughout the building. When I say open stairs, I mean that if you had an emergency on one floor, let's say a fire in a corridor, due to the stairs not being separated, you're actually going to fill all corridors in that school with the smoke and toxic fumes potentially, because there's no segregation of levels. That's the biggest issue within that building, and unfortunately, one of the reasons we brought Harriman in as well is to solve those issues in that building is a little bit more difficult given the way it was constructed over the years, and it's not a simple thing as putting up a door to stop the smoke and fire traveling up the stairs, because if you put a door, it actually blocks. There's no good place to put a door without blocking the usability of that space at the same time. In addition to the stairwell issues in the high school, there's a more general issue in the corridors. Given that the building sprinkled is actually a big benefit. However, it does, the code still requires that the all the corridors be smoke partitioned off so that a fire in one classroom doesn't permeate the rest of the building. And to my knowledge, the era of that building, none of the corridor doors in that building have the proper ratings that's required for that. So couple those two together and you have a significant means of egress issue to address in the future. Not the tomorrow future, not the September future, but to start putting a plan together to resolve these. As we work through this and talk to Harriman Associates with the building history, we were brought up to speed that there was a facilities committee a couple years ago, or maybe as recent as last year, that was looking at the future of the school district and whether or not that high school, and someone stop me if I'm editorializing too much, but the future of the high school and where that fit into the district's plan. Given this report that was reported to the state and the town, I think for the high school, I would strongly encourage that committee to factor in these issues into a master plan for the school district on whether or not it's the best use of funds to go after this building in a complete renovation sense. What the next step is, or let me slow down for a minute. That's the high school. In addition to that, I'm sure that everybody's aware there's accessibility issues. There's, you know, ramps that are difficult to navigate, some classrooms that may or may not be easily accessible, and all that goes along with those issues as well, too, which was in our scope a little bit due to it being part of the corridor system, but we weren't expressly looking at accessibility in the building.
I guess I've got a historical interpretation question for you.
Sure.
I'm thinking about like the main stairway that has the lift on it, for example, that's open access for, I can, you know, see that smoke would easily billow to the upstairs mm-hmm. should there be a fire in that space. Was that, when that was done, I'm assuming that when all the renovations occurred in that building, that we met whatever the code was on those days?
I don't know the era of the exact dates of those renovations or what plans and permit processes were done.
Mm-hmm.
I can't tell you that, yes.
So
that issue has been in the code for a long time, mm-hmm. about stairs being separated. So likely it was a requirement then. Now, whether or not
it was waived or something.
Right. There's no documentation that it was waived, so I don't believe that has a history there. However, there may have been some negotiations that mm-hmm. that resulted in that. And so, there was also, historically, the state and the towns and people in general have become more and more aware of safety codes and in light of the news and everybody, you know, seeing issues. They're more aware and more alert to what they are mm-hmm. than they were, say, 20, 30 years ago. So,
and you're looking at what the life safety standards are now, not what they were 5 years,
correct.
10,
and that
20.
Is what's applicable mm-hmm. to that building. The code actually separates between new construction and existing, and gives leeway where needed for existing construction that won't adversely affect safety but may not be the best scenario. And
for example,
that.
The sprinkling that we don't do, there's no sprinkler system in the elementary school.
That's correct. Nor is one required.
Nor is one required.
What I mean by that.
It's a good idea.
Absolutely.
But it's not required.
And there's a lot of benefits and a lot of givebacks in the code when you do that. It's just not expressly required.
Mm-hmm.
Does that answer
okay,
your question?
Yeah, thank you.
That does bring up an interesting point that maybe we should just put out there for public consumption on TV. In terms of the New Hampshire State Fire Code, a little brief synopsis of it is it does apply to all buildings. And one of the things we always hear in our line of work is our building is grandfathered. And we hear that quite regularly. So I'd like to just point out to the board that the State Fire Code does not actually grandfather buildings. It actually breaks up, as we just talked about, into new versus existing. and allows you to apply the existing rules to an existing building. So you do have to comply with the newest codes that are in effect. However, you have to comply with the existing section. So if it's non-compliant with the code of today, then it does need to be corrected, even if it was correct when it was installed. So it does, it forces you to upgrade your buildings as the codes recognize issues. So that's our review of both buildings, which I believe can be made public as needed to the board. The next step would be to have some type of a master plan established on how these renovations are going to take place. Because of the deficiencies from the code, they do need to be fixed. They need to be corrected. And they need to be corrected in a reasonable amount of time, depending on the severity of them. So that's a negotiation with the local and state officials on what the actual upgrade plan is going to be. But I would recommend that the board seriously start looking at convening some time to look at that and make sure that we're all on the same page. While I have the board here, my recommendation at this point would be to look heavily at the elementary school based on the age of that school, it not being as significant in terms of the facility. And my understanding in talking to members of the school district and to Dan at Harriman is that that building is long-term, relatively new, and is not projected to be retasked or any major modifications done. So anything you do to it is going to only extend the life of that building. And then we look at what the board would like to do or what the public would like to do relative to the high school and work with your facilities committee to best solve those problems. That's a synopsis of where we stand today. I'll answer any questions that anybody has at this point.
Are the building codes, you said that, you know, they're new construction versus existing. Are there different standard that hospitals or
yes.
schools or public buildings in general have to meet? So we're held to a different standard than if this was, say, a commercial space.
That is correct. The code has approximately 8 to 10 different categories, ranging from residential occupancy, single-family homes, to business offices, to mercantile stores, to hospitals, to nursing homes. And our buildings contain educational uses and assembly uses in the gymnasium. So not only does it distinguish new versus existing, it does look at the population that's in the building and apply codes based on that population also.
Okay.
So our review was done to existing educational and assembly spaces, which is what those buildings contain.
So if we were to put an addition onto elementary school, then we would have to code the sprinkler system into the building.
That has a lot of variables.
That was my question too.
Yeah. Can you?
I was under the understanding that if we make an addition to that school, then we have to bring the elementary
yeah.
school up to sprinkler system code or whatever.
And you do. And depending on the size of the addition and what it does to the size of the building and the footprint, that's why I say it's
yeah.
a bit of a loaded question. There's a lot of variables. It very well may.
Okay.
But if that's a determining factor, it may be possible to design it in a way that
yeah.
it doesn't. We haven't done any of that research, so I can't answer that definitively.
Okay.
There's some square footage yeah. calculations, and depending on how big the addition is relative to the school.
Yeah. I asked about the boiler system, the heating system itself, because of its age, in terms of safety, whether something like that could possibly start a fire or something like that. So that's why I asked. So you people didn't look into that, did you?
No, we are not mechanical
right.
engineers by trade.
All right.
Obviously, we can
yeah.
we can put you in contact with the right people and work
yeah.
with Harriman.
Yeah.
And Harriman has them in house. So
because we've talked about that, you know.
Sure.
That boiler's been there since the building was built.
No, absolutely, and it should be reviewed and
yeah.
it should be looked at annually, probably, and inspected annually. But our report was more based on what the fire department needed,
you.
And that was
you.
Where we directed our focus.
Yeah. We can use all the help you can possibly give us on this.
We'd be more than happy to help
yeah.
with anything.
Can I just ask a question, Jeff? In your review, was there, and I don't know if you had a chance to look at the review that Dan Bisson did when he was interviewing the schools, was there anything different in the report than what was in Dan's? Was there anything significantly different? Because you did a very comprehensive report when you did the facilities, and all of this was in that report. Is that
very
correct?
Similar.
Very similar.
Yeah, I don't believe that there's anything significant, and Dan can speak to that as well, that was drastically different. The focus of our reports was a little bit different. Dan's report a few years ago was focused on the facility and how it best serves the school district in all of its capacities, including heating systems and programming space and everything else. Our report was at the request of the fire department. It was focused more on the actual safety of the building and the requirements of the building, not so much on how the building was utilized.
Do you look at, in your process, the statistics on fire drill, you know, evacuation times and that type of thing?
Our report does not address that. There are requirements within the code operationally on when fire drills need to be conducted. But again, that's done at the local level in terms of verification and getting the documentation over the fire department. We were not asked to review the operations of the fire drills for this report.
Okay.
We can gladly provide the board with the highlights of what the code requires for informational purposes. But school was not in session when we did our report, and we did not address how the staff responded.
Yeah.
So it seems to me like the biggest issue is the compartmentalization of the building should there be a fire.
Yes.
And if we do upgrades for that, how that might impact the speed of egress?
Not so much the speed of egress as it is the actual programming space of the building and how it's utilized. There's some serious building renovations that would need to happen in some of those areas in terms of door relocations, walls being built, classrooms either being shrunken or enlarged as needed to create the space that's needed. Some of the ramps are too steep, which were good faith efforts that the school board and school district did to put in those ramps based on the footprint that they had to work with as codes have progressed and accessibility codes have progressed. The angle of those exceed what's required now, and in order to solve those problems, you need to make the ramps longer, and in many cases, there's a wall or a classroom in the way on where that ramp would need to come through. So that's why I say it's far-reaching. When you start getting into trying to solve one problem, you end up knee-deep into the school pretty quickly.
So then if you, using that as an example, you have to extend the ramp out another 8 feet, but now there's a wall at the end.
Correct, and the corridor is only, it's at the corridor, and the corridor is only 6 feet wide. Now you need to find 2 more feet.
And that
ramp.
Wall might be load bearing.
Correct.
So now you're, am I?
Yep.
You got it.
Dang.
That snowball starts at the top, and by the time you get to the bottom, you're looking at the whole facility, which brought, you know, and that's why we're fire protection engineers, and when it comes to that level, it really does help to have an architect on board who can work with you on programming space. That's why we gave Dan a call, not knowing your history with him, and it was just a blessing that we all know what's going on here. But you can see how it progresses quickly to, okay, now what do we do about this space, and while this classroom may be substandard now, and now we're going to take more space away from it, what happens to our usability?
And we're putting in I-beams to change load bearing.
Mm-hmm. We don't know that yet, but those are the potential.
And we've got at least 3, sounds like, significant changes like that each probably have a pretty good chance of.
We have 3 stairs that are concerns and probably 3 or 4 ramps immediately off the top of my head that have potential to be far reaching.
So aside from instructional space meeting square footage requirements of the Department of Ed and hallway widths and just other ADA compliance things, are there ADA compliance things the same as the ramp angles that you're speaking of?
Yeah, the 2 codes are pretty similar on what ADA requires versus what the state fire code requires for for means of egress. Mm-hmm. And when there are ramps in the means of egress, they need to be able to be traversed by people
sure.
who may be in a manual wheelchair, for instance, and have to have that angle be manageable. So that's kind of where our report got us to today. And now it's time to start that process of putting together a plan of upgrades and a plan of corrections to show that we're moving in the right direction and make sure the state's on board and the local, the local building department, local fire department are on board with what we're doing and in the order that we're doing it in. And then, of course, the budgeting end of it as well.
Does your report include any sort of prioritizing of these things? And I mean, I guess there's a couple different ways you could prioritize, right? You could be the low-hanging fruit that, $100 gets you all this stuff. And then there's the life safety critical prioritization.
Correct. And we're working through that right now. We're at a draft level working with Harriman to kind of balance the dollar values versus the safety values to try and come up with that plan that we think is appropriate for the two facilities, with keeping in mind that the future of the high school is
a bit uncertain.
Exactly. We don't want to be spending money that we're not going to get a return on, but at the same time we need to make progress, and they are code violations that need to be addressed, so we're kind of at a fork in the road.
Are there deadlines looming that we have to meet?
There are not immediate deadlines looming, only because we haven't put forth a proposed timeline. Typical rule of thumb is 3 years, depending on the severity of the violations, but 3 years to bring the building into complete compliance.
It sounds like, though, that there might be some flexibility in if we are making honest, good faith progress towards resolving these things. There isn't a drop dead.
There is not a hard and fast state rule or state law that says, because basically it says you have to be in compliance. And when it's found not to be in compliance, it's a negotiation with the local and state agencies to make sure that the minimum level of safety is maintained and that it's a safe building for everybody to be in. And contingent upon that, you build your timeline to catch everything by the end.
Okay.
But I would also like to just say, nobody's pounding on the doors of those schools asking for them to be emptied. We're not in a panic mode right now. There are code violations that need to be addressed, but they need to be addressed methodically and with the future of the school district and the finances of the school district.
Well, I'm glad that you said that, because I'm worried that we just, are scaring a bunch of parents at home.
No, and that's not my intent today.
Yeah, I mean, it...
The school, specifically to the high school, the school is sprinkled, the school is a fire alarm system. The right things are in place to give immediate safety to students.
Okay.
But to give complete code compliance safety, we need to do some upgrades to the building.
I can't help myself. Chris, I'm wondering if maybe I can put you on the spot to... I mean, we're talking about, if these are egress issues, I know you collect some data regarding that, but I don't know if I can expect anyone to be able to whip out a bunch of numbers. Are there general guidelines that we're within, we're close to, we're exceeding as far as how fast we get our kids out of the building?
Generally, we want to get them out in about 90 seconds. We're about a minute and 45. Typically, it will run differently depending on how many kids we have injured. Clutches upstairs going down and how that slows down the egress through the building. Last week we had 6 different kids on crutches because of sports related injuries. So with 508 kids, 6 kids on crutches, four stairwells, and they're all coming down at the same time. We didn't get out of the building in 2 minutes and 48 seconds for that reason. So it's always a concern. The number we shoot for is 90 seconds. That's what we've been taught by the local fire department. And it can be done. It can be manageable. We've done that many a times. They work with us. We do one fire drill at least a month. Planned or unplanned, and that's the goal that we target is 90 seconds. Yeah, so we're right around there. But again, the building is old; it's small, in the hallways, which also is a problem when you have close to 600 people trying to leave the building in 90 seconds.
Right.
It just doesn't happen.
And your comment about students that are disabled for one reason or another,
right,
corroborates what you're saying entirely.
You want me to reiterate that?
I think probably a good idea. Yeah. I'm sorry, I didn't.
Just for the people at home, just so they.
The question was, we try to get our students out within 90 seconds. That's what the local fire department has asked us to do. But with 600 people in the building at all times, in four stairwells to try and get students out, and anytime kids are on crutches, you know, we typically, in those days, don't get out until over 2 minutes, which is a concern. Our quickest time this year has been about a minute 47 seconds, which is pretty much right on where we want to be. But again, you know, different times of the years with kids having injuries or the different significant type of injuries, it does clog up the stairwells. And with the hallways being narrow and tight, there is a clog up, you know, upstairs, going outstairs. And that's always a concern.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Chris.
Any other questions or questions? What's the timeline for when you know, that priority list generation piece of the report will be?
We're almost completed with it, so a couple fine tunings and we can get that out to you in short order, a week or so at the upper limit.
Super. Well, thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much,
very
guys.
Very eye-opening. I'd rather loop back to the good news part of the...
Yeah, right.
Bob, did you have something else?
No, I'd just like to thank Jeff for his time and for Dan. Bisan, for being here. Appreciate it. Thanks for...
Thank you, guys.
...continuing
you.
To work with us.
And I will... I've asked Jeff to send me the report, and I can PDF that off to you, so you'll
great.
Have the actual report, because I've written all of them.
Great. Thank you.
Super. Thanks. Yeah, thanks very
Thank
much,
you.
Both of you gentlemen. Good to see you,
Thank
Dan.
You, gentlemen.
Lots of reasons to do something about facilities.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, if I may introduce the next item on the agenda, if you don't mind. I'd like to recognize Nancy Winterbottom and Mr. Jim Fabiano for being here. They're here tonight to talk about Standard 7 in the NEASC, and you're well aware that in the past several board meetings we've had presentations from the other standards, and this is a completion of the standards, this being number 7. This is very important to the whole NEASC evaluation process down the road, and about a year and a half from now there will be an evaluation committee coming to the school district to look at the information that the committees are coming up with now, the self-assessment and other information. So this is very important to the whole district and to all the schools. And certainly I'd like to say that we appreciate all the work that all the committees have put into this and the reports. This is a kind of a snapshot tonight of Standard 7, and eventually you will receive a full report and probably have more presentations and be informed about this. But I'd like to turn it over to Nancy Winterbottom and Jim Fabiano, and they can make their presentation. And thanks, both of you, for being here. We appreciate it. And Ms. Randrisky is still here to support them.
Thank you, Dr. Lister. If I may, I just want to divert for one moment, because part of the theme tonight has been about community. And just to acknowledge, and of course, the accreditation process is all about community and enrichment of the community. I just would like to acknowledge the Newmarket Community Education Partnership. Just for a brief moment, for those of you, especially at home, the NCEP group does many, many things for our community, our educational community in particular, but the staff at the junior senior high school today enjoyed a very generous luncheon. There'll be one next Tuesday at the elementary school, and I just think it follows on the good news theme that we want to support. So thanks to all of you today who contributed so much to making the staff really appreciative. So to NEASC, New England Association of Schools and Colleges, for those of you who are not aware of this process yet, let me just give a brief addition and synopsis to what Dr. Lister just mentioned. This is a 3-year process. It's extremely important to our community. It's important to citizens and taxpayers. School administrators, superintendents often get calls from realtors about whether a school is accredited or not and whether they're looking to move into a certain school district based on the accreditation status. The process is very, very valuable to staff because it provides an opportunity for teamwork and for collaboration around evaluation of the school standards. And it's extremely important to students because if a school is accredited, one might argue, but it's generally a conventional belief that if a school is accredited by the New England Association of Schools and Colleges, that that student's opportunities for the future are enhanced. So we believe that it's very important to go through this process. As Dr. Lister mentioned, it's a three-year process. We're coming up to the halfway mark. We have a tremendous amount to do next year, and the site visit will be held on November 6th through 9th, fall of 2011. So we have heard progress reports, if you will, from standards 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, 6. Tonight, Mr. Fabiano will present a synthesis of the standard 7. I think for those of you in the home audience, in terms of the standards, I think it's important to think sort of analogous to or kin to the American Medical Association, the American Legal Association, where there are standards for measuring success and need for improvement. And the education, public education system doesn't have an overall board like that. So that is why the New England Association of Schools and Colleges accreditation process in local communities is extremely important. So I mentioned our time frame. We will take somewhat of a break on this work during the summer, although there are some of us who will be working on a synthesis of all the work that the committees have done this year. Then we will resume committee work in August. And we have been told by your support that committees will have professional staff development days next year to work on this work, to complete this work. What we're hoping is that the various committees' work can be mutually accepted by all of the peers, and that next spring we will really focus on planning for the site visit in November, which will be a time when 15 to 20 professional educators from all over New England will be spending 3 days in our community. We will house them and feed them. We'll provide them a workspace. We'll provide them with technology, and we'll provide them with what are called indicators, pieces of evidence about all the work that we've been doing. So, any questions thus far or any comments? All right.
Thanks for the big
synopsis.
Picture again. It's
Thank
important
you. I wanted to make
to
sure
hear
that was clear. So, I will introduce Mr. Jim Fabiano, and he will, I hope, give credit to all the people that have been working on his Standard 7 committee. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Take my hat off. I hope the glare isn't too bad, but it's really the best I can do. My name is, yes, I do, in Jordan. My name is Jim Fabiano. I'm a teacher at the high school, have been for over 20 years. I was given the responsibility of Standard 7, which is community, how the community reacts with the school and the school reacts with the community. First of all, I want to express how proud I am of the people I work with. They've built a very large document. It's on Moodle, and it can be pulled up very easily if you wanted to see the whole document. Now, this was built during staff developments, but it was also built on their own time because everyone had an address and password to go into the document, and they could make changes all the time. So I just want to really make clear that these people worked very, very hard on this. Now, on this community involvement, this is something I thought I knew. I'm very proud of Newmarket. I'm very proud of the school. I'm very proud of this community. It has always supported this school. We talked about the luncheon today, which was absolutely remarkable, as you can see. And all the aspects. I've had incredible amount of support in this town for my department, which is science. They spend a lot of money on this, and we're very proud of what we do. Now, you have the document, I assume. Okay, and they break it up into different indicators as such. The first is the dependable funding for a wide range of programs. We were very happy with it. We worked through all the staff developments. We worked through all the intervention strategies for at-risk students. We have four professional days like I've talked about, and also Infinite Campus. Now, Infinite Campus was something, to be honest with you, I wasn't that thrilled with when it came in. But now, because of the portal, it is making community relations very easy. I am in constant communication with parents and students, and it's nice having the students not get a line and say, how well did I do on the test? I just put my finger up and say, the portal. And then they can get all this information themselves. Second part right here, it develops plans and funds. There is a long-range school facility, construction plan, renovation, and maintenance. The building is 1931. It's an old building. And the janitorial staff, I'm thrilled with. They keep the building as clean as they can. Any problem I've had with the building, let's say lights or something that I need help with, I usually get it fixed within a 24-hour period. So in that respect, I'm very proud of it. I'm very happy with them. I guess we brought it there. 4.5 people involved in the maintenance services. I've not met the 0.5 person yet, but they're doing a fine job. Three, the community funds and the school implements a long-range plan. The main thing we're concerned with, at least at the high school, and correct me if I'm right, Chris, is the drop of enrollment, that we're going through a little bit of a slump period. But if you look at the elementary school, we have a very large bubble coming. Now, I've suffered through bubbles, and I've worked my way through the down populations. So as far as long-range planning of curriculum, et cetera, I think we do a nice job at the high school of what we can offer. Four, faculty, building administrators. I'm very happy with the administration, as much as I can't stand having Chris here saying that. But we don't agree with everything. We don't. We have open conversation. It's not just me. It's the entire staff. And he opens the situation up where we can talk to him. Not that we'll always get our way, but we do every now and then. But, you know, it's just a nice communication, which is very important. Now, I have a budget I just produced for 2 years from now. And this is something I had to get my staff together, and they did a nice job on it, their needs for 2 years. And it's very difficult to do. But you have open communication throughout the whole school, which I'm very happy with. Number five, school site plant support. We're an old building. We do the best we can. When we have some budgetary systems, let's say for an LCD, and having it installed, or a smart board, or whatever those are, now they're called school boards, they're called everything in the world. And we also have the possibility of getting an infrared system on a regular whiteboard. So to get this interaction with the students, I think it's quite effective. Seven, all professional staff, engage parents. Again, we have Infinite Campus. We have open communication with all the parents. We have that Alert Now system that is very functional, that if there's a problem in the school, everyone is instantaneously notified. If there's no school during a storm or now floods, you know, at least we know the problem right away, which is exceptional. I'm just breezing through, you know, just to see the highlights. The school develops productive parent community. Again, the portal. We have the connection, which is very good. Now, Nancy talked about the connection with the community. This is part of what we work with. I use the connection with all my seniors. All of their recommendations are now going through that. And teacher connection, I think it's called. You can correct me on that, Jordan. Okay, and it's a good way, a good system of getting recommendations and giving all of our students the opportunity for post-secondary education. And Channel 13, I think you showed our search film on that. Did anybody remember that? Did they? We taped the Holocaust. It was a very good film out of the search program out of the University of New Hampshire, and it went on Channel 13. In fact, all the schools are showing it on their local TV stations.
Nice.
If you didn't see it, I can get it to you. Okay, it's really interesting. It was a Holocaust survivor. It was a Rwandan genocide survivor, and it was one of the poor boys, the military boys. He was one. And that was out of Sudan. So that was a nice program. Rec Center, that's my surprise. I didn't know how many programs they had at the Rec Center. They have a massive amount to help a lot of students, not only during the summer, but also during the school year. I was involved in one of the programs. We had a student couldn't really do much work in the class. He had a problem. So we actually worked at the rec center, and I gave him a syllabus of what he had to cover at the rec center for biology. And it was effective. First time I've done that. I think I've done it one other time since then. So they have programs at the school with the rec center that we really don't even, it's there. And that's what Newmarket Community is. They're always there. And it's nice. Let's see, eight. Now we're talking about school to career programs. I think it's exceptional. I don't have to like it when my students miss my class. I'll be perfectly blunt with you. But it's such a good policy that it's worth losing the student for the day if they get some possibility of, again, post-secondary education or post-secondary work. Finally, Newmarket, I am extremely proud of the connections with the universities and colleges. We have connections out of UNH. We have connections out of BU with the City Lab. We have a five-year connection with Dartmouth College. I think I talked about that about 2 years ago, 3 years ago. It was a grant from Howard Hughes, and they're using it extremely effective. And if you ever get a chance, they just produced a video that had the 6th grade and the 10th grade work together, which I think is important. And they showed it at Dartmouth, and they were very impressed at what the school did. And this is a program that doesn't cost us anything. It's all through the Howard Hughes grant. New England College, Great Bay Community College, Franklin Pierce. We go through many, many colleges. And also we have a connection with Beth Israel Hospital, where 2 years ago the anatomy and physiology class went down there to look at their new respiratory theater. And we've been invited back every year to do that for anatomy and physiology. I'm just proud of what this committee has done. They've done a lot of work. Do you have any questions?
It looks like a lot of work.
Yeah. Is my hair okay? Okay, thank you. I'm all set.
Thank you, Jim.
It's a lot of work.
Hey, Jim.
It's nice to see, and I had the opportunity a couple of years ago to be in the building when some of these initial meetings were coming, were initial meetings beginning, pardon the redundancy. The topic of the day was largely, what are we doing that we're not acknowledging that's so good? And it was really refreshing to see groups of teachers, A, having the chance to talk to each other, but B, in an environment where they could go, oh yeah, how about that? And so this whole NEAS process, I think, is wonderful to realize, yeah, there's some things we need to work on, but also the community connections that we have, I'm not going to go through the list, but I appreciate you joining us tonight and sharing those details. So thank you very much.
So Nancy, thank you very much for your time. And Mr. Fabiano, very nice. Thank you very much. Appreciate that very much.
Okay. Okay. Next on the agenda, we have an item regarding the AYP plan.
And yes, if I could just make a couple of comments, because we want to keep you updated, keep the board updated about the AYP process. A couple of notes I'd just like to mention, and there may be some other comments as well. This is going to be an ongoing report to the school board, so you know what's happening with the response, because we are a district in need of improvement. But most recently, the staff at the elementary school has met and discussed the reading and the math scores. They're reviewing the data on a regular basis. The administration has a summary of their concerns and ideas for continued improvement while looking at the student population that is still struggling. Those ideas and concerns are going to be discussed at a district in need of improvement planning meeting on May 27th. The math department at the junior senior high school has also looked at those scores in depth and will add their concerns and ideas to the planning meeting on the 27th. District in Need of Improvement Planning Committee will meet and review last year's DINI plan and begin a root cause analysis, not a root canal, but a root cause analysis. Sometimes we think it's like a root canal. Root cause analysis of the new AYP scores for further changes and improvements in teaching and learning. And the progress report will be completed and sent to the New Hampshire Department of Education by September 1st. The superintendent, myself, will be sending a letter to all parents in the Newmarket School District announcing the need of improvement status for year two, so they understand that. And the letter should go home to parents by June 5th, and we will also post all that information on the website. So not only are we looking at the scores and looking at the subgroups that really have some needs, but we're coming up with a response to that in teaching and learning, looking at student performance. And we're also interested in working with, you know, to follow up on the NEASC community report, to look at other resources in the community that are by us that we can enlist to assist us in this need. It's interesting that over 50% of the schools in New Hampshire did not make AYP. But we're still looking at a response to that, so we can talk about what professional development days have to be necessary, what we need to do to be training people and give them the skills that they need to be able to work with different kids. And we're looking at changing curriculum and new ways to schedule students and new interventions so they can be successful. So that's going to be an ongoing process. We will make sure that the board is aware of that. I think it's important for everyone to be on the same page, and also so people in the community are aware of what's happening, because people in this district are really making an effort to respond to not making AYP. We're not taking that lightly, but at the same time, we're going to need resources to be able to do this, adapt resources, change resources, and talk to other people. We have been in touch with several other districts about what ideas they have and strategies that are working for them. So that is also a work in progress as well. So we will keep you up to date about that.
Great. Thank you.
Could I also just add one other thing? I know that board member Kelly has...
Oh, you want me to...
Yeah, you want to say that now?
No, yeah. I after our meeting, when I think it was Pat presented us the AYP, I went back to work, and I just started thinking, well, who is it on campus at UNH that might be able to help us, you know, seeing that they're right next door? And so I did some poking around the website, the education department, and I actually came across this professor who I actually had when I went there. And I looked at his resume and everything, and he seemed like someone I had no idea if he would be or not, but I reached out to him in an email and just said, hey, you know, would you have any experience in this? And he replied and said that he'd be more than happy to review our scores and meet with us and, you know, make available whatever they can do to help us in this process. I don't know what that might be. I think Bob actually knows him. Is Todd DeMitchell is his name, and he's worked with him on other things, and he's just really a smart guy. So I just I reached it out there, and, you know, Bob said once we finally came to a place where we could actually come back to him, I will do that, and we'll see if it can help us in any way. I mean, I think it's only good to have options, so we'll see how that goes.
So, and we will follow up on that contact with Dr. DeMitchell, and because he has done a lot of work in with curriculum and teaching at the university. And again, and it's like, just another connection.
He seemed to have specific knowledge of like statutes and like, because I asked him about the No Child Left Behind, and so I think that would be a good, you know, resource for us. So I look forward to seeing what that might bring.
So thanks for suggesting
that.
Another great connection to the larger community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
With the university right down the street.
Door.
It's
And I would think that would be a great opportunity for them as well to, you know, especially for those students that they have there that want to get into the
project of some kind.
Yeah, this could be a great case study, a great, you know, they could really break new ground with, you know, some things that maybe they could develop, some systems and procedures and practices, you know, helping this community that could help the state, help the nation. Yeah.
So I look forward to hearing what you will reach out to him. And
yes, I will.
Okay.
And I'll report back.
Great. Thank you.
Super. Thank you.
Okay. On to committee reports. Bob, do you have Other items you'd like to
I do have a couple of items I'd like to mention, if I may. You have the superintendent notes, but I also would like to mention Mr. Andruski and I today we took a walk out to the new softball field. Mm-hmm. And the sod is just about all finished. They're being laid down. And I don't know if you want to mention this or not. I probably should have checked. I just want to say that I think the progress with the field out there is just unbelievable. And if you have a chance to take a walk out there and see what's being done, it's just a phenomenal facility out there. And I think you're very fortunate in this town to have this. The sod has been laid down. They're working on the soccer field now. But it's just very exciting to see that, the whole facility. So it's coming together and working with the athletic director and Mr. Andruski and other people in the recreation department to see how we can celebrate the success of that and with students. So we're working on something and more information to follow. So that's important. I'd also like to just mention that on June 7th, and I've mentioned this before, but on June 7th, the school department is sponsoring, along with Epping Newmarket Coalition for Family and Youth, a forum at the high school on anti-bullying and cyberbullying. And we will have a couple of speakers. The students will have an assembly in the morning with one of the speakers, and then we've asked him to come back at night and to be available to parents and make a presentation to parents and other people in the community, business people. Anyone's welcome to this. And to be able to talk about specifically Newmarket, what our response is to bullying and what resources are available, strategies for parents, and really be a resource for parents in the town of Newmarket. And I'd also like to just say that from 6 to 6:30, there'll be a light dinner with some sandwiches, a pizza. And 6:30 to 8:30, there'll be two speakers. And we would like to invite all parents. We will have childcare available for younger children. And we would like to invite all parents and business people to this because we think this is really important. This is a chance for the town of Newmarket to really kind of talk about in their own community about issues around bullying and cyberbullying and provide some information to parents, as I said, and other people. So we hope people come to this. We're going to advertise it pretty heavily beginning on over the weekend and on Monday. We're going to use the alert now. We're going to use all the websites, and we plan to use newsletters and get flyers out to parents. We really want to try and blanket the community and get as many people as we can to the junior senior high school on Monday, June 7th, beginning at 6 o'clock, 6 to 6:30, light dinner, and 6:30 to 8:30, a program. And we're looking forward to that. So I just want to take an opportunity to mention that.
Bob, you mentioned that this is part of the Newmarket Epping Coalition. Are folks from Epping welcome to attend this as well?
They're probably going to have a forum of their own in some format. This is just for Newmarket. And I know that there have been other several communities that have done the same thing. I know that there was one that I assisted in organizing in another town. They've also had one recently in Portsmouth. They had one in Winnicunnet in Hampton. So really specifically geared toward your own community and just have people come together. And again, if we're with the theme of community this evening, this is another example. So we're really trying to get that information out. I'd also like to congratulate Linda and Chet for being reelected to the school board.
Thank you.
I will ask, I put this in my superintendent notes, but I would like to ask all of you because every year I send out a reading list to all the staff, because we send a reading list out to students and suggest that they do some reading in the summer. We will do that as well. But I'm also suggesting that we have a reading list for staff, and I'm going to ask everyone on the school board, as well as all the administrators, to come up with their favorite book that they would recommend to the staff and give staff a reading list. It's kind of can be fiction, nonfiction, can be whatever. And I think the last time I sent a book out under my name, I think the last one I chose was Cooking for Dummies. So it doesn't have to be totally serious, but to give people some leisure reading and contribute to the whole effort in the district with reading and math. So I'll get to you, but I'll have a deadline that we want to get that done by. So, and the last item I'd like to just mention in my superintendent notes is the teacher evaluation committee has been meeting and working on the teacher evaluation instrument and process that mirrors the teacher contract, and they would like to come back to you at some point to make a presentation to give you an idea of how teachers are going to be evaluated and what the process will be. And we've also had a discussion amongst ourselves about evaluation of the board. I know last time or two meetings ago you looked at the board goals. I just want to again throw out the idea of a board retreat on June 26th, if we can kind of keep that idea in mind. That's a time when I believe that would be good opportunity to have Dr. Jim Hayes here and be part of the process, and continue on and look at how we will be evaluating people and talk about some standards and high expectations and accountability. And that's what I have.
Excellent. Thank you.
I'm sorry. Excuse me. Can I just mention one other thing? Race to the top.
Please.
Race, and people in the community may want to know about this as well, but you have some information in front of you as part of a packet. Race to the top. And let me just give you a little bit of information, and then I'll tell you why we're discussing this evening. The federal government, President Obama in particular, has put $4 billion aside through a competitive process under the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, the ARRA. We hear about ARRA money. For a grant program for the purpose of advancing reforms in schools in four areas. The first is adopting standards and assessments that prepare students for college. The second is building data systems that measure growth and success and inform teachers and principals how they can improve instruction. The third is to recruit, reward, and retain effective teachers and principals. And the last is to turn around the lowest achieving schools. This is not to be confused with AYP, because Race to the Top is a competitive grant program. Last year, the State Department submitted a proposal along with 26 other states to get money to be able to provide a reform, redesign activities in school systems in the state of New Hampshire. However, the grant was not funded because they didn't have enough support from the school districts. As a matter of fact, they only had 25% of the school districts that said that they would be interested in participating in the Race to the Top funding. The grants then were awarded to two states, Tennessee and Delaware. Why? Because they had 100% of districts in their states that said, we're interested in doing this. So they get the money. So how are we going to correct that this time? Because the Department of Education will be submitting a grant on June 1st for the second round of Race to the Top money. And they're asking, the state of New Hampshire is asking for $75 million over 4 years. And it's expected that 10 to 15 grants will be awarded this year. There's a list that I gave you that shows you each school district how much money they would be entitled to. And if you look under Newmarket, you'll see that Newmarket could be slated for $144,327. But we'll also benefit from the statewide, the state receiving money for professional development activities. And much of this has to go with teacher evaluation. But by the way, I'd just like to mention that Newmarket already has been involved in the redesign and process. There was a team that went to Nashua to a conference to talk about redesigning the high school, alternative methods of scheduling, different teaching methods for teaching and learning. There's a scheduling committee that looks at alternative schedules that's working in the district. The teacher evaluation committee that I mentioned is aligning the teacher evaluation system with the contract and the expectations we have. And there are many other opportunities that we've taken advantage of to be able to look at redesigning what happens in schools and providing effective and professional development. So I mention this because the DOE, the Department of Education, is submitting a proposal on June 1st and looking for 100% of the participation. I have to be honest with you and tell you that I don't think Newmarket's going to see any of this money. And I don't mean to be negative about that, but we are not low-performing schools. And most of this money is going to go to low-performing schools. 5% of the schools in New Hampshire, which are 12 schools in the state, have been designated as low-performing. Again, that's way beyond not making AYP. So the bad news is we may not see some of that money. The good news is, if the state gets the grant, we will reap the benefits in other ways by all the professional development activities that go on, which will be at no cost to us. So we'll kind of be able to, if you don't mind me saying, hooking on to other districts and being able to network and do some of the things that we want to do. So I think at this point, because they're looking for us to sign an MOU, a Memorandum of Understanding, signed by the superintendent of the district, the board chair, and the union presidents, each presidents, that we will have hopefully 100% of participation. Last night I attended a meeting at Exeter with the commissioner and the deputy commissioner, and I really think it would be a good idea for the town of Newmarket, for the Newmarket School Department, to be part of that participation in signing an MOU. And I know that John Bridle has, who's the union president, has been to some NEA meetings, AFT meetings, to talk about the issue around Race to the Top. I know that Cliff has had some information. The superintendents have had a lot of information, and there was a lot of hesitation in the beginning because there are some strings attached if the money comes to New Hampshire. But I think right now, in order to get that, to be part of the participation, it would be a good idea for us to be able to submit an MOU. And then when the state is funded, then we can decide what pieces of that we want to participate in or not participate in. And again, Newmarket is not a low-performing school district, but I think that we need to continue developing assessments. And and again, where I said this was not to be confused with AYP. Remember, AYP is determined by how we do on the kneecap scores, kneecap tests. There are many other ways that we're assessing students in schools, many other ways that we're assessing kids. And again, we recognize seven young people here tonight for academic excellence. That doesn't happen by accident. It's because there are a lot of good things going on. They have opportunities. They're being assessed and evaluated in different ways. So we need to continue with that. So I'd just like to acknowledge all the great things that are happening in the Newmarket schools as well, and ask your permission to submit a Memorandum of Understanding for Race to the Top, and we'll keep you informed about that. And I'm sure you're going to hear more about that in the future. The grant goes in June 1st. They won't hear anything until about September 1st, and they're hoping to have a kickoff next January. So it's kind of a slow-moving target. But there are, again, many opportunities. And if there are any questions?
Any questions?
If anyone needs any information on Race to the Top, I would be glad to give you more of where that came from and more information. So would the board allow me to submit an MOU with
yes.
the board president and board chair and the union president?
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for carrying the ball on that here in Newmarket. It'll be, and as you stated, there are no strings attached at this point. It's just the next step in working towards that eventuality. Okay. Now, with no further ado, Jordan.
Yeah.
Thanks, Jordan. I remember saying last meeting that I was going to have a pretty big agenda, so I do this week. So I'll start with sports as always. Boys varsity baseball is 8-4. Girls varsity softball is 7-5. And spring track's next meet is Saturday at Kennett, right? The blood drive is tomorrow. It starts at 2 and it ends at 7. So if anybody wants to give blood, please come down to the Newmarket High School Gymnasium. The NH Scholars were announced 2 weeks ago, I believe, and there will be a luncheon this t- next Tuesday, May 25th, in Concord at the State House. They all will be recognized for completing the criteria to accept this award. And at graduation, they will be wearing their medal that they will receive. So congratulations to all of them. And
that's a big group.
Yeah. I was just going to say there are over 30 students that were.
So that's not the group that was here?
No.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, it's like in when you are in eighth grade and you go in the freshman year, you get this like slip and you like write down all the classes that are required to get this award, mm-hmm. and then if you pass them, then by your senior year.
Nice.
Yeah. So they'll get to wear their medal at graduation.
That's and so that's 30, did you say?
Well, it's over 30.
It's over 30.
I believe it's 38.
About 70 students?
Yeah, about 70, 60
wow.
students.
So that's
wow.
Yeah, almost at least half.
That is amazing.
Yeah.
Good job. Got some good achievers.
Once again, Newmarket is not one of the lowest performers.
No.
Mm. Yep. And also, the top 10 luncheon is Wednesday, May 26th. I don't really know any. I know Ben is obviously in top 10. So have you heard any information about where it is or anything?
That is not information that I'm willing to share.
Oh.
I believe yeah. that is generally a surprise.
Oh.
For the
gotcha.
Top 10 students. So gotcha. If I knew anything, I might not share it at
all
this
right.
point.
Also good news. The National Honor Society induction dinner and ceremony will be next Wednesday, May 26th. The inductees were Ryan Carpenter, Katie Teague, Valerie LaVertier, Jessica Eisfeller, Henry Gilbert, Shannon Collins, and Amanda St. Pierre were all inducted, so congratulations to them.
Nice.
And the French trip is Friday. They are heading to Quebec, and they get back Sunday. I remember couple weeks ago also you asked if I could give you information about senior week, so I figured I'd let you guys know. On Tuesday we will be receiving our caps and gowns and going on our senior outing at Newcastle Commons. On
not
Wednesday,
wearing your caps and gowns.
No, not wearing them. on Wednesday there will be a mandatory marching practice from 8 to 10 in the gym, and our senior banquet will be held at the Portsmouth Country Club. On Thursday, there will be another mandatory marching practice from 8 to 10, and at 7 p.m. in the gym, the senior awards will be handed out. And lastly, on Friday, we will start setting up for graduation and have another marching practice. And finally, our graduation will be held at 6 on the fields behind the school, if the weather holds off, and if not, then it will be in the gym. After graduation at 9:45, the bus will leave the high school for our project graduation trip to conclude our stay at Newmarket High School. So,
wow.
Jordan, would it be a tent outside or would it be just open?
I think it's just open. Yep.
Do they know where they're going for project graduation, or that's
yeah,
a surprise?
Surprise.
As well? Oh, I can't wait to find out with that.
Super.
Mm-hmm.
Much to look forward to.
I know. I'm excited.
Terrific. Well, thank you very much for all those details. Okay, Facilities Committee is next. Clearly from the SFC presentation as well as the information of Standard 7, they both highlight the need to make progress in that area. Bob, do you speak to that?
Just that as a result of the information you heard tonight about the scope of services, and Sue and I would like to be able to get that information certainly to you, but we'll be convening a facilities committee to start talking about some of the issues, and we'll report back to you next time. So in the next week, we'll probably have a meeting and start having some conversations and developing a plan, a timeline, so we can keep this fresh in everyone's mind. I think that's very important.
Yeah, critical. Thank you. Okay. Sue, we have a update on the modular.
Just that on Friday, Brian and I, Bob Warrington from Schiavi, we see, and Rick Malasky met at the elementary site and went over the scope of the work that the town will be able to complete for us. We will probably begin the Monday when school ends, after school ends, the groundwork, and once that's all completed, we'll be ready to tie into water and sewer and all of those facilities we need and place the modular on the site. A couple of things that we need to think about is the type of pad that you have underneath the modular. You can choose to put it on gravel. We did check with Dan Vinson, and that is allowable if it's going to be a temporary unit. If it was permanent, you should really put it on a poured pad. So that decision needs to be made. You can save some money by not putting it on a poured pad, but if you intend to leave that there permanently, you would need a you would need a poured pad. So that's something we need to decide on.
We have time to make that decision.
Yes, you do. I can bring that back to you at the next meeting. I'll give you an update on that. And I do actually just receive today the, I don't know if you all had the site plan, you asked where it was, but I did get that, you know, how it's going to be positioned and the distances and all of that. So I do have that if you'd like that. But other than that, we're moving forward with that, and things seem to be going well. And again, I will bring that back to you at the next meeting with an update on the budget, because I know we have still have funds available, and there are still some things that we'd like to add to that list if you would like to approve some more expenditures before the end of the year.
So next meeting, if you could also have some of those prices for purchasing the modular or
sure.
renting it and so forth.
You want me to bring that back again so you can
yeah.
just
would you please?
Talk about that one more time?
That's very smart, especially with regard to, I mean, it goes hand in hand with whether we're going to put
pad,
it on a slab
right.
or not.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Sure, I can do that. And then I also have some updates for you, Chet. I know you mentioned the boilers at the elementary school. They're old, but they're in very good condition. And I'd like to tell you that everyone that visits that building remarks on how well those boilers are kept.
25
so
years old.
We do mm-hmm. we do maintain them every year, and Brian does an excellent job of keeping on top of them. There are two of them, so
yeah.
if one fails, we do have a second one. But there are some repairs that need to be made, so I'll bring that to you at the next meeting and add that to the list mm-hmm. to keep those boilers running.
Mm-hmm. And they are, the typical life expectancy of those is 20 years, so we're on the outside of that.
We are
that
on
might
the outside.
Speak to the some of the repair pieces.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
But also, they are 25-year-old technology, and there's an efficiency piece that,
exactly.
that layers into mm-hmm. what happens with mm-hmm. them as well.
Yeah, and when we have our retreat, I'd like to also talk about stuff that we had considered before with some of the other types of energy on that building.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I
sure.
think we
absolutely.
Should continue that.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'd like to know how Exodus is turning out.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of efficiency they're getting out of it, how much savings and so forth.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Be interesting because.
And I will send out that report when I get a clean copy to you, the report that Jeff spoke about
great.
This evening, so you'll have that.
And there's no changes to your end of year projections at this point?
At this point, no. I can tell you that it'll probably be more than at this point, you know, as we get closer to the end, we can kind of be less conservative.
Mm-hmm.
So you probably. There's nothing going the other way. If anything, we'll be going in a higher balance at the end of the year. So I'll tell you that.
Knocking on wood.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We have some resignations and other.
We have some resignations, requests for leave, and nominations. The first is Ann Kochi. She is. Asking for maternity leave and maternity leave. Yes, maternity leave. Thanks. I guess I would ask, what is your pleasure?
I'll make a motion to approve the maternity leave for Ann Kochi. Kochi?
I'll second that.
Thank you. Any discussion?
If I'm a little confused with the time here. If the due date is the 29th of August, so she's looking at or the September issue is that we're talking about the 6 weeks through that, so the entire month of September plus 2 weeks.
Yeah, because school starts like October. Right at the end of August, doesn't
yeah.
it? So it's probably the first beginning part of the school year.
Right.
And this is within, my expectation is within the
FMLA.
Guidelines of FMLA.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, that's correct.
Any other thoughts on the motion? Okay, all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
The second is a resignation from Elizabeth Abel. She is a reading teacher.
She's a school counselor.
I'm sorry, school counselor at the elementary, and she's been here for 2 years.
I'd like to make a motion with a heavy heart to accept the resignation for Elizabeth Abel.
I'll second.
Thank you. Any discussion?
The next is a leave of absence.
Sorry.
I'm sorry.
All those
sorry.
In favor signify by saying aye.
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 Jumping the gun, sorry.
Moving right along.
The next is a leave of absence. Beth Dismaris, who's a third grade teacher. She's been here for 9 years. She's asking for a leave of absence for 1 year.
Is there a motion regarding this leave request?
Dr. Lister, I just want to make sure that we're following the same procedure that we followed for a previous employee that asked for this. I know that in the current contract, it states that it's upon recommendation of the superintendent and principal, and the principal's not here, so I'm sure you're going to represent Scott's
yes,
view. And is there a recommendation by both of you to approve this?
Is to approve this request, yes.
Thank you.
And she meets the year requirement?
That's correct.
Yes, sir.
She's been here 9 years.
I'll make a motion to approve the leave of absence for Beth Dismaris.
I'll second.
Any further discussion? Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed?
And the last is a request for a resignation, actually, for Allison Malinowski, and she is a reading specialist at the elementary level, and she's also been with us for 9 years.
I'll make a motion to accept the resignation of Allison Malinowski.
Second that.
Thank you. Any discussion? Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Opposed?
And for those individuals, on behalf of the board and the school administration and their colleagues, we'd like to thank them for their service to the students and the community of Newmarket. We greatly appreciate what they've contributed to the town and the schools.
Absolutely, and I'd just like to add that folks are leaving from what I understand for, you know, relocating to different areas. It's not that they're leaving for the right reason. You know,
yes,
they
you.
Are leaving for the right reasons, which is, however hard it is to have that sort of turnover, that's a little bit of solace there.
That's correct. Thank you. The next list of nominations is for classified employees, which are office personnel, custodians, food service, district personnel, and paraprofessionals. And the board has had an opportunity to look at the list of these individuals. And I would ask you if you would entertain a motion to nominate these individuals to come back and join us again.
I make a motion to nominate the classified employees positions.
Second that.
Thank you. Any discussion?
Yeah, that would be for the 2010-2011 only.
Yes.
That's correct.
Yes.
Okay. Hearing none further, all those in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. All right. And we have no other nominations.
There were no nominations. That's correct.
Beyond the, that group. Okay, and we have a manifest.
I will make a motion to approve the total of all manifests in the amount of $487,962.68.
I'll second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Okay, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. And we have an enrollment report, which looked flat, as I recall, from when I reviewed it briefly. Any highlights to point out?
Mr. Chairman, can I just add, and members of the board, I think this is really important that you see this all the time. A lot of districts don't do this, because we hear from time to time people coming before us talking about the bubbles everywhere. So everyone's on the same page and it's consistent. I think it's important for you to see this information so you can see what the numbers are, and so we can plan ahead for the bubbles if they exist. So I'm really glad that you get this.
I think it's also valuable to see that, although it may seem that it's kind of everyone shows up for school on the first day and is there until the last day, it's really not what happens in the real world. There are people that move in and out of every community, and that poses challenges. And I think that's one of the things that I'm struck by whenever I review this. So thanks for that comment. Okay, on to the calendar.
In the calendar, you'll see there are some end of the school year activities, as well as an addendum to that, some other activities that are important dates that the two principals have provided us with, and I decided to include that as well. And as you can see, the next several weeks, the next 23 days, I think it is, very busy, and there is a lot going on in the school district, so everyone's going to be busy. And again, if I could just announce again that the last day of school for teachers and students is Thursday, June 24th, because last time we met there was a question of whether that would be different, but it will be the 24th.
Right, and it's a half day for students.
Half day for students and a full day for staff.
Okay.
I wanted to mention that tomorrow night at the high school there's an improv night. I don't know if any of you were able to attend the last improv, but it was really funny. The students did a great job tomorrow night, and I think it starts at 7. So
show up after work, donate a pint of blood,
and then
have a
laugh or two,
sandwich, and
there we go.
There's the Friday night plan. All right. I also note here the policy committee is listed under other.
I have policy committee listed here because we are planning a meeting for next week, because at the next board meeting I'd like to bring before you two policies to get back on track with so we don't fall so far behind. One would be the athletic eligibility policy, and the second would be the internet safety. I'd like to start with those two, and then we'll go from there. And if and next time we meet, if you have ones that you think we should highlight, feel free to offer those, and but we thought if we could do a couple at a time, that would keep us back on track.
Great.
Is there a reason that you chose those two to start with? Are they the most outdated or the most challenged?
The athletic eligibility, because there have been several questions about how students are eligible for sports, and I think that has to be clear.
Yep.
And the second, internet safety, only because we're in the middle of cyberbullying and all kinds of, so that might be good just to kind of reinforce that.
I had mentioned too at our last meeting, I had a conversation with Chris Andruski, and you know, he had also mentioned, you know, that there are some policies that he really feels we need to look at again, and you know, maybe we need to make sure we're reaching out to the principals and
Yeah, I have spoken to both of them and asked them, because I have others besides these two. But I also have some from the special ed department as well. Good. They have some that I guess were supposed to be introduced a while ago and weren't, and they really need some direction with those. So,
great. Okay. So we do have other personnel matters to discuss this evening, so I'd entertain a motion to go into non-public session, return to non-public session under RSA 91A, colon 3, Roman numeral 2, part C.
Mr. Chairman, could I just maybe one or two other things before you do that?
Sure.
Sorry. You have a copy of the teacher contract that I gave you before we started the meeting. I'm going to pass those out to teachers tomorrow. I want to remind, again, I hate to keep harping on June 26th, but it's very easy to lose that date. Mm-hmm. So I'm just trying to...
it's in my calendar.
Okay, thanks. And the last thing is the summer board meetings. Would you like to know that we're setting the board meetings for one in July, July 15th, two in August. Notice we say we. August is the 5th and the 19th. That's the first and the third week. So one in July, July 15th, and two in August, August 5 and 19. Thank you.
Which one's in August?
5th.
And 19th.
I mean, unless you decide to do something different, okay. I'm just proposing those.
We need to probably all review our calendars a little bit. But
I'm going to be out of town the first week of August. But so I will be missing that meeting.
Okay.
Okay.
And Kelly was mumbling, I think, something about the same. Are you going to be out of town?
The 19th is what I'm looking at. I've got to go double check where exactly how far it extends into that week.
Okay.
I'm only proposing this date, so whatever you all decide.
Okay.
We'll
get back to you.
But we're all planning on that date, whatever that was in June.
The 26th. 26th is cold.
That day again?
And I know Jim Hayes has also got that on his calendar.
Good. Oh, good. Right. Do we know where we're going yet?
We're working on that.
Oh, okay.
It's a surprise. It's like the senior banquet.
Are you going to pick us up in a limo and take us there? And
yes.
We won't even know. All right, good. So now we need to go into non-public.
Yes. Would anyone like to make a motion regarding that?
I'll make a motion to go into non-public. According, okay. Do I have to say all that mumbo jumbo?
You could say for the discussion of personnel, I think that
for the discussion
meets
of personnel.
The need. Yes, I've already read the RSA reference.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Could you please call the roll?
Yes, you will. Chet Jablonski?
Yes.
Linton Mantegani?
Aye.
Kelly Foster?
Aye.
Meg Looney Moore?
Aye.
Cliff Chase?
Aye. Okay, thank you.